Why don't we get started? Because I know I stand in the way of you eating lunch. So might as well just start early so you can have lunch earlier and get fed and so forth. And again, thank you for being so patient with the lecture and trying to follow everything. Thank you. But it was very hot, and as you can notice, I'm taking off everything. It's just like in Seoul when I was literally wearing the same outfit, and in the morning I actually had a tie. But if you've ever been in Seoul at the end of August, it is horrible. It's terrible. I mean, the city in Seoul is beautiful, but the weather is hot, humid. And so literally by 11 a.m., I had already, took off my jacket and my tie. And so thank you for being able to, stay awake in the midst of Seoul-like weather. So anyway, so Korea since 1945. So Nami Lee, again, is going to Professor UCLA. She'll be giving you, as you know, a lecture, I think later, maybe in 2 days, about the colonial period. And I know it's a little odd for her to come after me, because chronologically it makes no sense. So what I'll do, though, nevertheless, is talk a little bit of the colonial period, because you can't really understand what happens in post-1945 North and South Korea without knowing some things about colonial Korea. So this is an iconic photograph. So in August 15, 1945, World War II ends. And so Japan surrenders. And as I'll talk about this in detail in a second, you have the United States troops coming into the southern part of Korea in September 1945. And that's the government general building. That's where, between 1910 and 1945, that was the equivalent of like the White House for Korea. That was where the governor general, who was the main Japanese ruler in Japan, lived, resided, and that's where his offices were. So it's the center of power in Korea. So you have then the Japanese flag coming down with the arrival of the U.S. troops, and then you have the U.S. flag going up. And at this time, and this is something that you have to give benefit of the doubt for, like, the U.S. soldiers. You would probably, now in our present mind, say, that might not be the best thing to do. It to put down the Japanese flag and then put up the United States flag, because even though to many Koreans at the time, Americans were considered liberators, this can be perceived in a way that can say, well, they're not actually the liberators, right? It symbolizes something, and it's only because of the place that they're doing it, right? At the former place where the Japanese were. So what we want to understand is what happens to Korea after 1945 in North and South Korea. So let's talk about the end of colonialism and the rise of division. So if you want to look at division, so why, let's first try to ask, why was Korea divided in 1948, North and South Korea? We have to first look at what happened in the colonial period. So in the 20s and 30s in colonial Korea, there were vibrant debates about the future of Korea under Japanese colonialism. Two things Koreans were debating. One, they were debating, what should a modern Korea look like? And that question was really important because at the time, there were all these new influences coming, Western influences. I'm talking about fashion, political beliefs, about democracy, right? New forms of consumption, music, jazz was coming into Korea. And it's becoming really popular and absorbed by Koreans. But when this will come in, it doesn't mean that the pre-existing disappears. No, you still have Confucianism, you still have Buddhism, right? You still have customs and traditions. So Koreans in the 20s and 30s are trying to ask, how can we reconcile the pre-existing with the new to make something about it? Make it Korean for ourselves, instead of just embracing everything from the outside, everything that's Western. So they're debating then, what should a modern Korea look like? Now the second question that they're asking is, how should we achieve liberation? Well, under colonial rule, what should we do? We have this vision of modern Korea. Okay? So the left, socialist, communist, had an idea of a revolutionary state, a leftist version of the state. Some people on the conservatives on the right had very traditional views of the modern Korea. So they had these visions, and so like, how can we implement it? And so then they said, well, some say, particularly on the left, let's be aggressive. Let's fight against the Japanese. Some people on the right are saying, no, let's build up the institutions that would help us to make a strong Korea so that once we achieve independence, we'll never lose it again. Because we have all these strong institutions that will create a national identity. So, we have these debates. Now, these debates end 1937 to 1945. Why? Japan goes to war with China, invades China, into a wartime mobilization. And Japanese clamp down any type of discourse or discussions on independence and what modern Korea looks like, and mobilizes Koreans. So what ends up happening is all that vibrant debate is just put down. That doesn't mean it disappears, because people are still thinking, but they can't vocalize it. So keep that in mind. Okay? So you have suppression, 37 to 45. Now, all of a sudden then, liberation happens. August 1945. Again, you will get this PowerPoint, so you can look at the details later. The United States comes in into the South, and the Soviet Union comes into the North. North is the 38th parallel, South is the 3rd parallel, that's the West, North is the Soviet. And you come in, and the Koreans, they set up in the southern part their own new government before the U.S. comes in. U.S. comes in early September. So between August 15th and early September, there's a space where they can try to actualize their vision of a modern Korea. Oops, sorry. Okay, so what we have to remember, though, what's happening at this time, as Koreans are starting to mobilize, it's the Cold War. Basically, the Cold War started at the end of World War II. Okay? And already, Roosevelt and Stalin at Yalta were already thinking about what should the world look like after the end of the war. Because Nazi Germany was, at that point, going to be defeated, they thought. And so they decided, okay, well, Korea, what should happen to them? And they said, well, we're going to create a trusteeship. And the basic of trusteeship is this idea that the two countries will come in and govern the country for a span of 30 years to build up, in their definition, a democratic society. And so that's the kind of agreement. And Roosevelt, if you know anything about Roosevelt, thought, Roosevelt was a big internationalist. So he really believed in engaging the Soviets all the time. Because he thought the power of capitalism would win over. He was a strong believer in that. And so he had no problem engaging with Stalin. But Truman was very different. Truman was very different. He was a little bit more conservative, and he didn't have the sophisticated worldview that Roosevelt had. So when Roosevelt died, there was still a trusteeship, but that trusteeship was looked upon by suspicion by Truman. Because he's like, that's giving Korea basically to the Soviets. Because eventually, we think Koreans are going to like the Soviets, because they're going to promise land reform, and all this equality, and all these things that are attractive in a communist society, which was very attractive at that time to a lot of people in the third world. So what you have happening then is, as the Soviets are controlling North, as the U.S. is controlling the South, you're starting to see Korean society evolve in different ways. Right? So what happens is, Soviets kind of take a hands-off approach, and they say, we're going to let Kim Il-sung and his comrades build up a new Korean society. And what they start doing, Kim Il-sung does major land reforms. We have to remember, 90% of the population are peasants. Peasants rent land. What do peasants want the most? To own land, not to rent land. When we're thinking about that, renting land is not only an economic thing, where you're giving rent to an owner, it's also a social thing, in which you find in Korea, the landowner often controlling and telling what the peasant to do. So to own land is not only economic liberation, but social liberation. So that's why land reform is very popular. So the North Queens said, let's reform land. Nationalize land, take it from the landowners, give it to the peasants. And that's what they do in the North. They create new types of systems that emphasize gender equality. So if you look at the North Korean Constitution today, there's a strong emphasis about gender equality. Whether the realization of that, if it happens, it's another question. But legally, you have gender equality. System of control and surveillance, I'll talk about that in a second when I talk about North Korea. In the South, it's a little bit different. The US, under Truman, starts looking at Korean nationalists very suspiciously. Because the Koreans are starting to look at the Americans very suspiciously. They think the Americans are here to stay. Right? And think about it, with that one photo that I showed you from the very beginning, that's the first thing that they see of the Americans. And the Koreans very much at first want to work with the Americans about how do we create our ideal society. But we're starting to see within the United States foreign policy circle, starting to see where polar politics is really influencing them about Korea. They are starting to see that Korea can be an ally to the United States in the fight against the Soviet Union and the Korean War. And there's a big worry that if under trusteeship, eventually Korea, once it becomes independent, will go in the Soviet camp. It won't stay in the US camp. So that's influencing what the US is doing. And so in the South, they take a very anti-communist stance. And again, what I want to really emphasize here is we have to be very nuanced in the way we think about communism in South Korea, the southern part of Korea at the time. If you said you wanted nationalization of land, or you wanted land, people in South Korea would say, in the southern part of Korea before 48, would say, you're a communist. Why? Because that's what the North did. When in fact, if you ask a peasant, they would probably be ideologically indifferent. They just want land. So, but the authorities, American authorities, perceive that as anti-communist. So what ends up happening is you start seeing them starting to pressure these nationalist movements to give up these large-scale claims that they want or goals, like nationalization of land, creating a career for Koreans. You're starting to see the U.S. kind of act in a way where they want to start influencing and controlling parts of some part of Korea. So what ends up happening, long story short, is that Soviet Union and the United States cannot reconcile their differences about the future. Because basically trusteeship is dead in the water right when Korea becomes independent, because Roosevelt is no longer there. And so there's a constant back and forth between the Soviets and the United States, and they finally decide, you know what, we're just going to create two independent Koreas, two Koreas, a northern part of Korea and a southern part of Korea. North Korea, the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, established in 1948, and the Republic of Korea, also established in 1948. So South Korea, ROK, DPRK is North Korea. And so it's from that point you have competing competition between the Koreas. Now, to bring back what I said earlier about the influence of the colonial period, it's at this time between 45 and 48, Koreans were again starting to debate about what is the future of Korea, what should it look like, and they were going to ally themselves with any specific power, whether that be the Soviets or the United States, that would allow them to achieve their independence. So there's a lot of people in the northern part who are not necessarily pro-Soviet Union saying, well, I support the Soviet Union, because look what they're facilitating our vision of society, the materialization of society. So that's how this colonial period is influencing politics. And it becomes really bitter between Koreans about trying to either work with the Soviets or the United States, competing with each other to make sure that their views become hegemonic, become the ruling beliefs. Right? So it's in this period you see bloody assassinations, you see violence between Koreans about how can we create our modern Korea, an independent Korea. So this is August 1948, when South Korea was founded. Now, let's move fast into the Korean War. 45 to 48, really the origins of that type of division, we can say stems from what happened in the Cold War. And then geopolitics. So geopolitics and what happens in the colonial period influences 45 to 48. So now we want to understand what caused the Cold War. And like any good historian, wars don't start on the day that they actually started. Historians will always say it happens because of processes and influences well before the actual first battle. And that's the same thing with South Korea, the Korean War. It didn't start on June 25th, 1950. And it never ended. And I'm sure you know this, the Korean War has never ended legally. It's still an armistice. And that's something you should know and keep in mind, because this is the chief motivation of North Korea to pursue their nuclear program, because they feel unsafe against the outside, because technically they're at war. So this is why during negotiations they're always saying, we want a treaty to end the war. There is no treaty yet. So the war is not officially ended. So, again, so where's the origins of the Korean War? Again, from the colonial period, we have ideological differences of what Korea should look like. And Kim Il-sung in the North believe we should have a communist, socialist society. And Syngman Rhee, who is the president of South Korea, has a little bit more traditional view. He believes he's more about capitalism and creating this democracy just like the United States. But a lot of those views come from the colonial period. It's just a continuation of all the ideological debates. What should modern Korea look like? It is between this period that 48 to 50 that in South Korea, Koreans are battling with each other because they don't like Syngman Rhee. Syngman Rhee is considered, in some people's mind, kind of authoritarian ruler. And he's not doing anything to alleviate the concerns of the people. And so you have a lot of people very sympathetic to the North rising up. And that includes people within the South Korean army. So you have major rebellions from the military against the South Korean regime. And so what ends up happening is that the preceding events really start shaping finally that conflict that happened. There's so many conflicts between 40 and 50. Koreans and South Korea are battling with each other about, well, we want to look like kind of like North Korea. Again, we have to be very nuanced. They don't want to become they're not pro-communist. They're not necessarily leftists, but they're sympathetic to some of their ideas. And again, Syngman Rhee and his regime are not very much supportive of those ideas. So, this is just a map, and you can see later of major rebellions, the Suncheon rebellions of 4850, where you have the Republic of Korea military uprising against the government. So, you have these ideological violent battles, but you start also seeing skirmishes between the North Korean troops and the South Korean troops in the summer of 49. So there's battles on the DMZ. Not large-scale battles, but people shooting at each other, basically. And so, the events of June 1950 was just an escalation of the already kind of conflict between the North and the South. So Bruce Cummings, who is probably the most well-known historian on the Korean War, wrote The Origins of the Korean War. He says, civil wars do not start, they come up, they originate in multiple causes, we blame enough for everyone. So what, again, I'm not denying that the Korean War started in June 1950. It did. But we also have to see what happens before 1950 as the influences for the origins of the Korean War. So, in June 1950, the war starts. North Korea invades the South. Historians are still trying to figure that out too, about who really shot the first shot. But most established historians will say North Korea invaded the South. To make a long story short, the interesting thing is, Kim Il-sung wanted to invade South Korea before 1950, but his truths were tied up with the Chinese Communist Party in China. Which is important to understand now why there's such a close relationship between China today and North Korea. It's a historical tie. North Korean troops fought with the Chinese in the Communist Revolution. Syngman Rhee wanted to invade North Korea, but the United States wouldn't let him. They were so fearful of that, they never left any tanks, only small armaments. But the United States certainly did not want a ban on the war. So, but the war starts. And this is just a timeline. Okay, again, we'll get this timeline later. Couple things. South is immediately taken by the North. Other things to highlight is the North, the South, and I'll talk about the second, eventually are able to overtake the North. They come too close to the Chinese border. The Chinese come in and they declare war on the UN, which is the main force fighting on behalf of the South Koreans. Incheon Landing is probably the most well-known battle. I'm not a military historian, but if I was to emphasize one, it's when MacArthur decides to go in October 1950, comes into Incheon, which is a port. North Korean troops are here, they take the peninsula. He comes in and he divides the North Korean troops. He goes to the southern route to defeat them here, and then he makes his push up north. And he makes his push up by October 19th to the border, which frightens the Chinese and then they come into the border. So, as I mentioned here, China's war. Again, a lot of wartime atrocities on both sides. Needless to say, that happens in any war. You have South Korean troops fighting on civilians, right? North Korean troops fighting on civilians. Often the case it happened when the North Korean troops would come down to the South, they would go into a village, control it, they would find South Korean sympathizers, and same thing with South Koreans, when South MacArthur and the U.S. and South Korean troops were at war, captured some villages, they would find North Korean sympathizers, and imprison some, but also shoot others. And it wasn't just the military, it was Koreans also doing them themselves, like vigilantes, basically, groups getting together to exact kind of revenge. Well, I need to say it's the Korean War ended stalemate. In July 1953, you have an armistice, but these are what happens. Multiple deaths, divided families, and also the rise of war. So let me, at 30 minutes, I'm gonna go in and try to describe another 60, 70 years, very quickly. But before I go to South Korea, let me just talk a little about North Korea. So after 1948, Kim Il-sung is the president, who you see right here. Kim Jong-un succeeds his father in the 90s after his death. I'm sorry, Kim Jong-il. Kim Jong-un is Kim Jong-il's son. And I always like to show my students the steady progression of his facial feature is how it gets heavier and heavier over time. And most authorities of North Korea, who know North Korea, say that that's deliberate as well. Because if you see pictures of Kim Il-sung in the 1948-49, his grandfather, they look very similar. And many people argue that deliberately done so this would give him legitimacy. Because no one knew who his son was. Kim Jong-il's son was when he came into power. And he's very young, right? So you need to do something to give him legitimacy. So make him look like his grandfather, who has significant influence in that country to this day. Now, a couple things I want to emphasize. I'm not going to go into details about North Korean history, but the one couple things I want to emphasize is this concept of Juche. And Juche is the political ideology of North Korea. Basically, it can be defined as self-reliance autonomy. The idea for North Koreans about Juche is that we Koreans have to always be self-reliant. We can never rely on foreign powers to sustain our independence. If we do, we will be colonized again. we always need the economist. So this is the belief system that influences every part of North Korean society. Every part. It is the ruling ideology that is breathed and lived by North Koreans, for sure. And I'll talk about in a second how that belief is spread. That ideology appears through various concepts. Chajusong, self-reliance. Chajusong in Korean to English, self-reliance. We need to be nationally independent. We need to have an independent economy, an economy that does not rely on the global economy. The global economy comes in, what will happen? We'll be controlled by financiers, we'll be controlled by the capitalism world. One thing we should know is Korea, North Korea was a heavily industrialized society. In fact, its GNP, GDP exceeded South Korea until 1980. North Korea had a strong industrial base because the Japanese built up industrial plants in the northern part of Korea. Pictures. Non-aligned movement in the 60s and 70s, Kim Il-sung, on the basis of Juche, said, we should never align ourselves with the Soviet Union or the United States. We need to be non-aligned. Non-aligned movement throughout the world was a mass movement by mostly third world countries, former colonized countries, that didn't pledge allegiance to the United States or the Soviet Union during the Korean War. Kim Il-sung was one of the leaders of the non-aligned movement. How does he build up a Juche society? Very simply, culture, movies promote that, propaganda posters, music, every aspect of culture. It's always about independent Korea, building an independent Korea. Education, which is one of their ways to spread their ideology. And then discipline surveillance. It is a very sophisticated discipline surveillance. So you'll be punished if you do not follow the rule. Over time, the rule in the local areas has decreased because they just don't have that type of influence in certain local powers, in local areas. But they still have a strong surveillance system. Now that we're going to South Korea, and we'll do South Korea in about 15 minutes. Needless to say, one of the largest economies in the world. Where is that coming from? Well, it didn't really start under Syngman Rhee. Syngman Rhee did not start an industrialization program in Korea. Most accounts, he was an authoritarian ruler, meaning he didn't do much, controlled the political realm, and tried to preserve his own power. The national security law is important to understand because it's during his reign that they pass it. The national security law still exists in South Korea. It gives the government power to arrest anyone with any suspicion toward collaborating with North Korea. So you don't have to have any proof or evidence. They can arrest you and keep you in a certain number of days in prison. That's still a law in South Korea. It's been modified over time, but it's still a law. Now, he used that law not necessarily to arrest North Korean sympathizers, but to arrest his opponents. So there's a lot of impropriety during the election, and then students rise up. April 1960 movement, the students said, this is enough. We want a democratic society. And they had just cause for it, because in the Constitution, it protected civil liberties. It said that you need to have representative democracy. The Constitution looked very similar to our Constitution in the United States. So it wasn't a contradiction. They said, it was a contradiction to them. Reality did not mirror the belief system, the legal system. So the students uprose. And what ended up happening is, Syngman Rhee shot, he ordered the police to shoot on the students, which was a massacre. And what ended up happening is that Syngman Rhee was eventually forced to step down, and by the United States in particular. He had no legitimacy anymore. I'm not gonna go over Changmyeon that much. There was an interim period where there was decentralized rule, but that's not so important. What's more important is that you do have the rise of a new figure, and that is named Park Chung-hee. May 1961, second and last, I mentioned he stages a coup d'etat to overtake the prime minister and the new government that established after Sun Yat-sen left. You see the multiple times he's elected president. Again, he's considered an authoritarian ruler because he suspends a lot of the civil liberties and all the protections against individual autonomy and the concepts of democracy. He doesn't not only suspend it, but he doesn't follow them out. So that's why people will label him as an authoritarian ruler. That's when he takes over, May 1961. That's Park Chung-hee in the middle. That's a picture. The most significant thing about Park Chung-hee, though, and this is where he's really respected, especially by older generations, and even younger generations, more older generations, people who lived there, he led a campaign for state-led industrialization. He basically argued, we need to build a new industrial economy that would be powerful in the world. Why? Because then that would make Korea secure, from North Korea and from any other threats. So think about it, he had the idea like Kim Il-sung. He wants independence for Korea, but he's just going it in a different way. He is going to particularly work with chaebols, which I heard earlier, I think you were introducing, Hyundai, LG, large-scale conglomerates. It was a partnership between government and these chaebols to build up a new industrial-based economy. The government would provide capital, money, guidance, tell you're going to build a steel plant, you're going to build the car industry, and then the companies like LG, Hyundai, Samsung would follow out and produce things. So that's a state industrial company partnership, which is not unique to South Korea. That's also in Japan that you find. You find it in China today. You find it in most Southeast and Asian countries in the 60s, 70s, and 80s. Where did they get the money to start this industrial program? By normalizing their ties with Japan. 1965, Japan and Korea, South Korea normalized ties. In return for normalization, South Korea and Japan gives them money, a immense amount of money you see here, to invest in their economy. The other significance of this treaty is the comfort women particularly. In the treaty, it said that all historical issues will be resolved through the compensation that they provided, including the comfort women issue. They didn't articulate comfort women issue then, but that's what the Japanese government today uses as a way to say, we don't have to give compensation to comfort women. It's already been done. So that's already the other significance of this treaty. The signing of the treaty, this is just more detail about how Korea gets money. They fight in the Vietnam War, they get a lot of money from the United States. It's the second or third largest number of troops in Vietnam after the United States. Park Chung-hee, again, sets up authoritarian rule. And so, during the time it's not without incident, his wife does get assassinated. They meant to kill Park Chung-hee, North Korean agents, instead they killed his wife. Okay? And at that time, the significance about this is that's when Park Geun-hye, the most recent president, steps into a role as the first lady. Park Chung-hee is assassinated in 1979. By the late 1970s, people are basically upset about society. Again, like the April 1960 students, women, labor activists, Democratic activists are saying, our constitution says we have all these protections, but you know, labor rights are being trampled upon, people are not being paid fair wages, they see that the chaebols, the elite, are only getting money, and so there's discontent. By late 1970, there's a large number of upscale revolts. Park Chung-hee is about to call in the military, and it's at this point his KCIA agent comes in and shakes up because he thinks that it will lead to chaos if the troops are unleashed on him. So what you start seeing in the 1980s, And in fact, Nami Lee is much better at describing this. So ask her a bunch of questions about the Minjin movement, because she wrote the definitive book on the Minjin movement. Minjin means masses. And in this case, the South Koreans started a new Minjin movement, a mass movement for democracy. They said, oh, okay, we're economically, we're becoming a great power. People are starting to become wealthy, but we don't have the liberties that you see like in the United States. They're wealthy, but they also have political liberty, autonomy. They have a true democracy, representation, and people are upset about that, and they don't have it. And so people are starting to rebel. Long story short, the government comes in, clamps down, particularly in Gwangju, where they decide to, in Gwangju, which is a southern city, the people take over the city in response to this one guy, Chun Doo-hwan. After Park Chung-hee's assassination, Chun Doo-hwan has led an investigation to see, oh, why does KCIA agent assassinate him? Well, then what happens is that Chun Doo-hwan, who's a military general, decides to stage a coup d'etat. He rises to the against the caretaker government. People in Gwangju don't like that. They start organizing themselves. Chun Doo-hwan sends in the military. And by all accounts, I think there is about officially 800 people who were killed, citizens, but most historians put the level higher above that, around 1,000 to 2,000. But this event totally delegitimized Chun Doo-hwan. I can tell you confidently, and still people really revere Park Chung-hee despite his authoritarian regime. No one likes Chun Doo-hwan because of what he did originally. He staged a coup d'etat and in their minds massacred people. And to many people in the 80s, he wasn't a very sophisticated good leader like Park Chung-hee. So just because they're both authoritarian rulers doesn't mean that they were equal in being revered. So Chun Doo-hwan takes power. As you can see here, he's arresting people in the democracy movement. The Minjin movement is emerging. It's becoming stronger. Okay? The key point I want to make here is university students and laborers are at the forefront of pushing against Chun Doo-hwan's authoritarian government. But around 87 and 88, they're joined by the middle class. There's a growing middle class, and why that's important to understand is, by that point, the middle class are upset at the government because they believe the government's corrupt. Because under this authoritarian regime, they perceive Chun Doo-hwan as just giving money to his supporters. And so, under this idea of there is no meritocracy, in fact, it's a society where people, if they know the government, will be able to succeed. So the middle class are upset about this. And they start joining up with the laborers and the students. Which then eventually leads to Chun Doo-hwan, around 87, decides he's going to put his right-hand man in power, Yoo Tae-woo. That's when you start seeing people coming out to the streets. Saying, we can't have this happen again. And so what ends up happening is, and So that's Yoo Tae-woo, his right-hand man. People start protesting. Large-scale protests. If you look at Time magazine between 87 and 88, there's a lot of coverage of South Korea. Why? Because the Olympics. And so you can find a lot of these images. Mass protests, not only in Seoul, but throughout the country. Against the government. And if you see, actually, this is not a unique moment. If you look at the protests against Park Geun-hye, which just happened this past year, very similar. Right? I mean, if I was to say that I don't like stereotyping Koreans and generalize them, but there is a strong protest DNA and culture within them, a protesting against unjust power. Right? And Koreans are very good at organizing against that unjust power. That's the Olympic Stadium. Most theorists say that what really pushed Yoo Tae-woo to meet the demands of the protesters was not only because of the sheer amount of people protesting them, but because of the Olympics. Everyone was watching Korea at that time. So there's always, political theorists like to say there's always the Olympic pressure when trying to understand political change. Sorry, I'm going fast, I'm just going 90s. I want to leave some time to talk about the North Korean conflict. That's why I'm moving on very rapidly. 1990s, Kim Il-sung becomes president. He's not an authoritarian ruler, but he is cracking down on labor activists. There's still labor protests because people are upset about wages, particularly, and inhumane working conditions. So Kim Il-sung, in some ways, cracks down on that, but there's not a strong protest movement that you find in the 80s. And to be honest, people were exhausted. They've been protesting since the 60s. And then like at the 90s, they're like, I want to live life. I want to consume. I want to spend time with my family. So that's what some historians say. There was this kind of exhaustion of the early 90s. But still, I don't want to dismiss that there wasn't any kind of crackdown against certain groups. That's Kim Il-sung. Significance. Three significant points about Kim Il-sung's regime. He puts Chun Doo-hwan and Ngo Tae-woo on trial. Why? Because they were the ones who led the Gwangju military response that massacred these people. They're convicted, but they're later pardoned. It's significant because you're putting two former presidents on. Ngo Tae-woo eventually also becomes president. You're putting them on a trial. The IMF bailout, basically, if you know, in 1997, Korea underwent a massive bankruptcy. It's under Kim Il-sung's rule. I'll talk about that in a second, the details of it. And he leads the bailout, which fundamentally transforms Korea to this day. That's Ngo Tae-woo, that's Chun Doo-hwan. The other significance is Kim Il-sung leads the globalization. Globalization in Korea is called Saegaewa. This is at the point where Korea decides it's going to export its culture. So this is when the roots of K-pop, this is the root, the economic roots, the push by the government to promote everything Korean under the globalization campaign. Also to import. So they're going to start decreasing certain tariffs that prevented foreign goods from coming in because they were so expensive, particularly cars. In the 1990s, there was 100% tax on most foreign cars, which protected then Hyundai, right, and the native automobile industry. But by the 90s, there was strong pressure to decrease those tariffs. Now, long story short, the Asian financial crisis starts in Thailand, and this is economics 101, which I don't have time to go through. Basically, everyone, outside investors, have complete distrust of Asian economies. They think Asian economies have too much debt, which is true because most development was financed by debt given by foreign banks, Japanese and US banks. But there's a mutual distrust of all the economies, and that's all right if you have a lot of debt. If bank loans are rolled over, meaning that you could continuously give them loan. But right when there's mutual distrust, all of a sudden, all the banks start calling in their loans immediately. And then what does the South Korean government have to do? It has to tap into their foreign reserves, their collection of money, to support the debt, to pay off the debt. And then you have, by December 1997, a bailout. Bails out the South Korean economy. We'll give you money, but you have to structurally reform the country, the economy. Again, the details of the structural reform are in my PowerPoint slides. I'm not going to go over them right now. At the same time all this happened, Kim Dae-jung is coming into power. And this is monumental because he's a democratic activist in the 60s, 70s who the government attempted to kill, assassinate multiple times. But he becomes president. And the symbolism of it is, it shows that Korea finally is a democracy when you have reformers becoming the president. he leads the IMF reforms, right? He also leads a new policy, a policy to North Korea. His new policy is called the Sunshine Policy. And this is very important to understand because it is a policy, it's one of the first policies in South Korean government's history of active engagement. And so what Kim Dae-jung decides is that in order to build a reunified Korea, we need to first have cultural exchange, economic exchange. We need to support our North Koreans who are going through a famine, which I'll talk about in a second. And we need to have cultural exchange, intellectual exchange. Then we can talk about political unification. So, June 2000, he meets Kim Jong-un for the first time. This is the first meeting between the North and South Korean leaders. He gets the Nobel Prize for it. His person who followed him, No Min-yeon, continues the Sunshine Policy. He's also middle to the left. So is Kim Dae-jung. His politics are middle to the left. But he commits suicide in 2009 after his president ends because of corruption allegations. I could talk about that later too, if you're curious about high rate of suicide in South Korea, because there is a high rate. At Film In-hyun, he's with Kim Jong-il again. And that's what happened, a memorial after he died. So now the final part, North Korea and the nuclear issue. Kim and Ro supported active engagement. So that happened since the late 1990s into the early 2000s, the Sunshine Policy. One thing that I'll go this quickly, 1990s, the North Korean economy was ailing. Why? Two reasons. One, they had no oil. They got cheap oil from the Soviet Union. But when the Soviet Union collapsed, they didn't get cheap oil anymore. Why is that important to understand? Because their industrial farming sector was heavily industrialized. They relied on oil, fuel. So you can't farm. So they had problems with agriculture production. Combine that with natural disaster, major flooding, as well as drought, it's disaster. So everyone knows in the 1990s, North Korea underwent a crisis of famine. It's at this moment that you start seeing then the nuclear issue arising. This is just a list. Again, look at it later, but the details of what happened. And if I was to just kind of summarize it, 1990s and under Clinton, active engagement in North Korea, to the point that they were going to dismantle their nuclear program and their missile program. That's in the news today. 2000s, under Bush, a different approach, right? More of a approach of trying to dismantle North Korea, wait it out. Right? Wait out North Korea, it will implode. And then under Obama, the same thing, which I'll talk about in a second. If I was to say anything about the North Korean nuclear program, you have to look and connect it to the concept of Juche. It's their desire for independence. They don't have much leverage in this world. They don't have a strong economy. The only leverage is they have nuclear weapons. That's the only way that they're going to extract treaties and resources from other people in the world to sustain their independence. So Juche is connected to their nuclear program. What's made worse in terms of North Korean-South Korean relations is the last two presidents, Moon Jae-in and Park Geun-hye, took an aggressive stance against North Korea. Suspended aid, famine aid to North Korea, and suspended the Sunshine Policy. Because their supporters were very anti-North Korea. North Korean relations, they just deteriorated under the two regimes. Right? Under Park Geun-hye, who was just stepped down, impeached in April, this past April. Obama really doesn't shift his policy towards North Korea, it's no different really than the Bush era, waiting it out. So, Trump, it's a lot of unknowns. Really a lot of unknowns. As y'all know, in a lot of areas, a lot of unknowns. And I'm finishing up, I just have a couple slides. The one, it's made unknown because he says, like, I'll beat the North Korean president. But then, you know, there's a Biden saying, you can't do that. And then what's complicated, of course, right now is the recent death of that student. So, it's unclear. There's no policy against North Korea right now. So this is actually a time where people are debating, should we create a new policy of engagement? And actually, people are using the student experience to say, this is why we need engagement, to prevent people from going there and being unprotected. Because if we had diplomatic relations with them, there would be a U.S. embassy there who would protect the rights of American citizens. And plus, you wouldn't have to go through a Chinese tour guide, which to all accounts was not very safe. So there's a lot of debates being had right about the future of North Korean relations. Everything's been complicated because what Obama did and right before he left. He set up the THAAD system, the anti-missile system. It's important to understand this because it angered China tremendously. To the point that, because they see this as a threat not against North Korea but against China. The THAAD is an anti-defense system. Will shoot down any supposedly missiles from North Korea. China saw this as a defense system against their missiles or troops. Chinese are very, very worried about what happens on the peninsula. They do not want to see unification happening and seeing U.S. troops along their borders. Because there's 27,000 troops in South Korea today. But China retaliated. Basically what they did was, I'm sorry, two more minutes. What they did was they suspended a lot of K-pop concerts. And they prohibited, which is a big deal because it's a huge market. And they also prohibited certain economic activities, certain, like the Lotte Corporation. Lotte has, which is a huge conglomerate. They have a lot of shopping malls in China. They shut a lot of them down. So South Korean companies are actually asking the new administration under Moon Jae-in, the new president was elected, to suspend the THAAD, which he has done. He suspended new installations of the THAAD system, but he hasn't removed it. He has also called for a new approach to North Korea, a Sunshine Policy 2.0, basically. Because he comes from the party of Kim Dae-jung and Nomi-yeon, so he's from that legacy. He just yesterday called for combined North-South Korean athletes under one team for the Pyeongchang Olympics. This is the last slide. If I was to say one thing, and I would conclude because I'm a historian on the value of history, is if you look at a lot of the problems in North and South Korea, I mean, you're all educators, I know you value history, but it's common sense here that history plays a significant role in shaping every part of contemporary politics in the North and in the South. Particularly in the North, the legacy of colonialism. That doesn't disappear. If you see any documentary, kids constantly go to museums where they're reminded of colonialism and the Korean War. They're constantly inundated. So colonialism is always among North Koreans. For South Koreans, it's also colonialism. But the real question of the modern really preoccupies them. And what I mean by that is all these Western things are still coming into South Korea. Some South Koreans ask, what's so Korean about our society? When you have literally Starbucks, McDonald's, and you know, wiping out indigenous, you know, coffee places, traditional tea places, South Koreans are asking, what's the future of our Korean identity under globalization? And that's a debate that happened starting in the 1920s and 1930s. So I'm sorry for taking so much time, but thank you.